The Christian in Complete Armor by William Gurnall. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18. Chapter 11. Satan's policy to discourage the Christian from prayer, under a pretense that the mercies he would beg are too great for him to hope he shall ever receive. Satan discourages the Christian when on his way to his duty from the greatness of those requests which he hath to put up to the throne of grace. Thou art going to pray, and will nothing serve thee less than pardon of sin, love and favor of God, with eternal life, etc.? Surely thou art too free of another's purse and too kind to thyself, if thou thinkest to be welcome at God's door with so bold an errand. This is a boon reserved for some few favorites, and darest thou think so well of thyself that thou art one of them? Now, to arm thee against this, that thou mayest neither be kept from the duty, nor go misgivingly to it upon the account of the greatness of thy request, ponder upon these five considerations. Section 1. Oppose the greatness of that God thou art going to make thy address unto, against the greatness of thy request. We are bid, Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 3, to ascribe greatness to our God, and if ever, especially when kneeling down to pray. Wert thou to put up thy request to some puny prince, thou hast reason to consider whether thy pitcher were not too great that thou wouldest have filled. Possibly thou mayest ask such an one more than once than he is worth. Help, O Lord my King, and the woman in the famine of Samaria, yet she had not relief. If the Lord do not help, whence shall I help thee? 2 Kings chapter 6, verses 26 through 27. Or possibly, if he hath power, he may want a heart to part with so much as will serve thy turn. There are many of Nabal's name in the world, such churls, who think every bit of bread lost that they eat not themselves. Yet some who grudge their own necessary food. Wert thou at the door of such, what couldst thou expect but cold welcome? But remember, he is a great God, great in power. Thou canst not overask. Thou mayest draw thine arrow to the head and yet not overshoot the power of God. Even when thou hast drawn thy desire to the highest pitch, he will be above thee. For he is able to do exceedingly above what we can ask or think. Wouldest thou have thy sins pardoned? Yes, if they were not too great, thou sayest. But can God at once discount such a sum, and discharge so vast a debt, that hath been gathering many years by a full trade of constant sinning with so great a stock of means and mercies as I have had? Yes, he is able abundantly to pardon, without any wrong to himself, or control from any other. The sovereign power of life and death being in his hands, he is accountable to none, as not for acts of justice, or so neither of mercy. It is God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? Romans 8:33-34. If indeed a man forgive thee a wrong done unto him, thou canst not think thyself therefore acquitted by God. His wrath may still abide on thee. Man cannot give away God's right. Were a man so kind as to forgive the thief that robbed him, yet it is not in his power to discharge him of the penalty of law, but if the prince who is the lawgiver will do it, none can gainsay. If God will pass an act of mercy, thou art free indeed, for the power lies in his hands. Is it any masterly lust from whose tyranny thou wouldest beg deliverance? The God thou prayest to is able to break open thy prison door and make thee, a poor captive, go out free. He can give these thine enemies as dust to thy sword, and as driven stubble to thy bow, yea, destroy them with a cast of his eye. The Lord looked on the Egyptians and troubled their hosts. Exodus chapter 14, verse 24. His every look was as heavy as a millstone about their necks. Presently, they sank horse and rider like lead to the bottom of the sea. And sin and Satan are no more before God than were Pharaoh and his host. In a word, is it comfort thou wouldest ask? Oh no, he is a creator that prayeth to, though thy heart were as void of comfort as the chaser word of light. Yet he can, with a word, cause new heaven of joy to arise out of that confused soul, and make thee in one moment to step out of darkness into light. Neither is his mercy less than his power. O launch therefore into thy bottomless sea by faith. Behold the wonders of God in these depths, and do not stand reasoning thyself into unbelief by any uncomely comparison between God and the narrow-hearted creature. He is God and not man. None of these defects are to be found in his mercy, which we, impotent creatures, find in ourselves. The paleness we see sometimes is not in the sun, but from the clouds that interpose. The stars do not twinkle, as is thought. But we, because of their vast distance and our weak organ, cannot behold them with a fixed eye, nor have their jealousies and fears entertained by tempted souls to the departure of the mercy of God, any foundation of his divine nature, but are mere bugbears, which through the darkness of their troubled spirits, Satan hath the advantage of affrighting them with. O beware, therefore, thou dost not disfigure the sweet, lovely face of God's mercy, which smiles alike upon every poor, penitent, praying soul, while thou fanciest God to have a partial eye, to look more favorably upon one than another, lest by this you betray the glorious name of God, to be rent in pieces by your cruel unbelief. If you once come to wrap up God in your hard thoughts, as slow to hear, hard to be wrought on with your prayers and tears, truly then Satan may easily persuade you to commit any sin against him, because you expect no mercy from him. Section 2. Oppose the promise of thy fears. There is no mercy thou canst desire, but is promised unto the prayer of faith. The mercy thou wouldest have is already voted in heaven, and the grant passed. Only God stays for thy coming over to the throne of grace, there to lay thy claim to the promise. Therefore, he issueth it forth. The mercy lies in the womb of the promise, but stays for thy prayer of faith, to give it a fair deliverancy. The children are come to the birth, saith Hezekiah. The promise is big. Wherefore, lift up thy prayer for the remnant that is left. Isaiah chapter 37, verse 3 and 4. That is, if anything will help it, it must be that. What can a petitioner desire more, and is addressed to a prince for some great favor, than to be assured not only the prince is of a gracious, merciful nature, but also that he hath obliged himself that which he hath in his thoughts to desire? And shall only the promises of God be counted a little worth? Have you not heard of such a promise? Ask, that your joy may be full. Did ever a vain word drop from the lips of truth? Doth he make an order one day and reverse it another? Are not his words yea and amen forever? 2 Corinthians 1:20. Beggars used to be quick-sighted. Benhadad's servants saw light at a little hole, and gathered from a few kind words which dropped from Ahab's mouth that there was mercy ranked up in his heart towards their master, which they soon blew up. Joab saw David's bowels working together. Absalom threw the casement of his countenance, and therefore lets down the widow's parable as a bucket to draw out that mercy which lie in his heart like water in a deep well. How much more encouragement hast thou, Christian, to plead with thy God? Who art not put to guess at God's thought, but hast the assurance of plain promises for thy good speed. Oh, what fools and how slow of heart are we to believe the good word of God? If Moses supposed his brethren would have understood by the kind visit he gave them and his friendly office in rescuing one single Israelite from his oppressor's hand, that God would by him deliver them all, how much more may God expect that his people should understand his purposes of love towards them when he exposed his heart to so open a view of their faith by his promises and have sealed the truth thereof to with so many examples, to whom already full payment hath been made of the same? And do we yet read them as the eunuch that sweet promise, Isaiah 53, and understand not the meaning of it? Do we yet sit so near our comfort as Hagar by the well, and our eyes not able to see it? Can we walk over the promises as barren ground, when, with a little digging into them, we might find a treasure to pay all our debts and supply all our wants? Section 3. Oppose to thy fears not only the greatness of the promises, but also the valuable consideration upon which they are made. Thou indeed beggest alms, but Christ demands the same as a debt. God is merciful to thee, but just to him, and therefore, Christian, though it becomes thee to sink thyself beneath the least mercy in thy own thoughts, yet it behooves thee to be tender of Christ's credit, whose merit is as far above the greatest mercy thou canst beg as thou art beneath the least. The Father will give you little thanks for casting any dishonorable reflection upon a son on whom himself have heaped so much glory, yet with whose honor his own is so interwoven, that whoever dishonors the son dishonors the father that sent him. Now there are three privileges purchased for every believer, and none of them can be lost by us without dishonor to him. First, he hath purchased a liberty to pray. It hath been death to come on such an errand to God, till he had by his blood paved the way and procure a safe conduct. Hebrews 10:27. Secondly, an ability to pray, as he purchased the Spirit for us, called, therefore, the Spirit of promise. Thirdly, the safe return of our prayers. Whatsoever we shall ask the Father in my name, he will give it. John 16:23. Indeed, it is his business in heaven to own our cause and to present his blood, for all his saints beg, and that no demur may be made to their request, so that either thou must blot this article of Christ's intercession out of the creed, or else thyself to shame for questioning thy entertainment with God, when thou thus hast so good a friend at court to speak for thee. Section 4. The greatness of thy request cannot hinder thy success. They are most welcome that ask most. Who are the persons frowned on at the throne of grace but those who lay out the strength of their desires and bestow their greatest importunity for mercies of least worth? They have not cried unto me with their hearts when they howled on their bed. Hosea 7:14. Mark, the Lord did not account that they prayed at all for all their loud cry, and why? But because he disdained their low spirit in crying loudest for that which deserveth least, as it follows. They assemble themselves for corn and wine and rebel against me. They would have a good crop with a full vintage, and these scraps should serve them so as not to trouble God for any more. God's love and favor are quite left out of the story. May they but have their bellies crammed. They have all their wish, and leave the other for those that like them better. Oh, how God abhors those carnal prayers, when men tithe mint and cumin, but neglect the weightier things of the promise, such as an interest in Christ, forgiveness of sin, a new heart, grace here, and glory hereafter. Or when they aim at low and base ends in praying for these things, which in themselves are noble and high. And therefore fear not the greatness of thy request. God hath rather give thee heaven and earth. He can more willingly bestow himself on thee, who art in love with him, than a crust of bread on another that regards him not. The greater the mercy is thou askest, the greater revenue wilt thou pay him for it. The less he gives, the less he receives. By low request thou wrongest two at once. Thou art a thief to thyself in wanting what thou mayest have for asking. Neither art thou so good a friend to thy God as thou shouldest, for the less grace thou hast from him, the less glory thou wilt return unto him. Their reflect beam are proportionable to the lightsome body they come from. Where grace is weak, the reflection it makes a praise and glory to God can be but weak. Section 5. God is so free and redundant in communicating his mercy. that he exceeds his people's modesty in asking. He gives them commonly the prayers with an overplus, more than they have faith or face to ask, as Naaman when Gehazi, asked one talent, would need forced two upon him. Abraham asked a child of God what he wanted an heir in whom he might live when dead. Now God promises him a son, and more than so, a numerous offspring, yea, still more than his offspring, all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. Jacob desired but God's care, under the protection of which he might go and return safely with food and raiment enough to keep him alive. Genesis chapter 28. Well, this he shall have, but God thinks it not enough, and therefore sends him home with two bands, who went out with little besides his pilgrimage stuff. Solomon prays for wisdom, and God throws in wealth and honor. 2 Chronicles 1:10. The woman of Cana begs a crumb, and God gives her a child's portion. She came to have her sixth child made well, and with it she had the life of her own soul given her. Yea, Christ puts the key to his treasure into her own hand, and leaves her, not as it were, to serve herself. Be it unto thee even as then wilt. Matthew 15:28. End of chapter 11.